Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session with the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance on the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax, Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Order 2024. The Minister is joined today by Scottish Government Official Laura Parker, LBTT Policy Lead, Director for Tax and Revenues. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Good morning, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to yourself and to the committee. The Land and Buildings Transaction Tax, Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Order 2024, provides for amendments to Schedule 2A of the Land and Buildings Transactions Scotland Act 2013 and also introduces a new Schedule 6A to that Act. The amendments to Schedule 2A relate to arrangements in place for the additional dwelling supplement. They address key stakeholder concerns with the existing legislation and ensure that the arrangements for the ADS work as intended. The new Schedule 6A provides extended relief from both residential LBTT and the ADS for local authorities purchasing property to meet local housing needs. This broadly aligns the treatment of local authorities with that of registered social landlords and will help support our wider housing policies. The Scottish Fiscal Commission considered the financial implications of these amendments in their December 2023 forecasts. The order was developed following a thorough consultation and review process. This included both an initial call for evidence and views, followed by a consultation on draft legislation. The result of that process is a package of amendments that addresses key stakeholder concerns with the legislation in its current form, ensuring taxpayers are able to claim the reliefs and exemptions that they are entitled to, and extending support where needed. I welcome the contributions from a wide range of stakeholder groups in developing the content of this draft order, and I hope that the committee will support it this morning.
Thank you very much for that helpful opening statement. I should have said that we have apologies this morning from Mike O'Mara, whose transport difficulties won't be here till later. I'm afraid we don't know where Ross is, but you still have five members of the committee. And before we open out to colleagues around the table, I'll be asking a few questions. What I would say first of all is that this SSI piece has been fairly broadly welcomed. However, there are one or two issues that have been raised with us. One is from the Scottish Police Authority. So what's been said is that despite acting under a statutory duty, the Police and Fire Reform Scotland Act 2012, seeking to comply with the housing standards and house acquisitions being funded by Scottish Government annual grant and aid, due to a lack of direct connection with housing legislation, there is no exemption from LBTT or ADS available to the Scottish Police Authority. I'm just wondering why this SSI hasn't been used as an opportunity to change that.
Well, we're very grateful to the work that the committee did in terms of reaching out to stakeholders for a further evidence ahead of this session that's useful. We very much note the points that have been raised by the SBA. We are looking into this matter and giving it careful consideration. It is not something we were able to address as part of this set of amendments. The committee appreciate the role of local authorities, for example, in regard to housing is quite distinct and different from other public bodies and authorities. However, it is something that we are looking at carefully and very happy to engage directly with the police authority on this matter and to update the committee in due course.
Okay, thank you. What the police have said is that while not a registered social landlord, the Scottish Police Authority has undertaken to align itself in principle with the requirements of housing associations and local authorities and is committed to working towards achieving the energy efficiency standard for social housing and the Scottish quality housing standards for its housing stock. So it does seem, you know, unfortunate that it has been omitted. If there is going to be further consideration of this, when would we expect an SSI on this basis to come forward?
I'm not in a position to give timescales. Clearly, we will consider this in relation to any aspects pertaining to housing relevant to other public bodies. We will, of course, consider this not only from the perspective of tax, in this case LBTT, but more broadly with engagement with housing colleagues. But as a made reference to earlier, more than happy for government and government officials to engage directly with the police authority on this matter.
Okay. Now, the Chartered Institute of Taxation has said that the only issue with this SSI is that it's really overly restrictive, and they're concerned that the Scottish Government is bringing in kind of these SSIs piecemeal, and that certainly appears to be the case. So they've suggested, and I know members of this committee have suggested, Liz, for example, that we should have a regular fiscal bill which allows for a point in time which all amendments to legislation are carried out rather than undertaking these piecemeal changes to tax legislation. I mean, given the fact that it looks like you might have to bring forward another SSI just to look at the police authority, would that not be a good way forward?
I recognise the interest in this. Liz Smith and I have had exchanges in the chamber on this matter, and it is something that I think there is merit in further exploration of. What I would note that is having a annual finance bill is an undertaking for government, but it's an undertaking for Parliament as well. So I think it would be very important for Parliament to be involved within that process. I think clearly there would be an important role for the committee. Now, I recognise the committee, of course, has a significant programme of work, but I'm very happy to engage with the committee to explore how we can build upon the work that was undertaken pre-pandemic through the Devolved Taxes Working Group. I'm very keen that we can look for ways and how we can build upon that. But what I think is important is recognising that while there is an argument for an annual finance bill, it is important that we take account of the views of Parliament and how that would manage. What I would say, of course, is that with this particular SSI that we're considering, that is a result of quite a broad consultation and engagement process. We are also, through the Scottish Aggregates Tax Bill, bringing forward amendments to the powers for Revenue Scotland, and I appreciate the committee will be considering that legislation later in the spring, and I'm sure we'll have the opportunity for further conversations in that space. So we are using legislative opportunities to bring forward reforms, whether that's in primary legislation or, as the case may be here, via an SSI. I think the fundamental point around looking for something that is perhaps more legislatively neat and efficient, there is merit in that. I think it's not just a matter for government, as I say, but for Parliament as well, and very happy to engage in that to explore what we can do going forward.
I mean, South Lanarkshire submitted a short but fairly interesting contribution whereby they talk about the flexibility or the lack thereof in SSSI. They talk about, well, it's important to recognise the need to ensure clarity on what is exempt from the tax. We suggest it may be beneficial to consider some flexibility in this area, particularly as current grant conditions do not cover all property acquisitions a local authority landlord may require to make. And they go on to mention some groups, for example, homeless households or gypsy travellers. So where is the flexibility in terms of this SSI in order for local government to kind of take decisions on specific groups that they may need to with regard to LBTT, etc., and EDS?
What we have in the SSI reflects the work that was undertaken through the call for evidence and the consultation, and the provisions within it relate to housing under the 87 and 88 Acts. So I think this represents progress. I know it's been welcomed by local government, but what I would want to state, I think this speaks to the previous point we were discussing around future reforms, is this is not this is a process rather than an event, and of course tax policy will continue to develop both more broadly in the work that government is committed to around a refreshed tax strategy, MTFS, but also in those operational and administrative and technical matters. So with regards to the particular points that have been raised by the local authority, I'm happy to consider further as part of that ongoing work as we keep policy under review. Clearly, we always have to give detailed considerations to these specific asks. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, Laura?
No, I think that's pretty comprehensive. As the Minister said, the Scottish Government did engage in quite an extensive consultation process with local authorities, and the draft order that's in front of you reflects the key ask from local authority stakeholders in terms of the scope of the relief. But as the Minister says, tax maintenance is very important, and the Scottish Government is always happy to keep these things under review.
Okay. I mean, what would be the financial impact on the Scottish Government of this SSI?
Well, the SFC have given their forecast, and I think for most of the measures it's below their materiality threshold. I think they estimated a maximum of £7 million over the period with regards to the extensions for the timelines from the 18 to the 36 months. But we'll see that.
So over what period, and is that £7 million extra revenue for the Scottish Government or less revenue for the Scottish Government?
Do you want to come in with the details just to put the numbers in front of you, Laura?
So it is £7 million of relief given to taxpayers across the forecast. So and it hits that £7 million figure in 2028, 2029. Prior to that, it's slightly lower. So it's sort of £1 million.
So just for clarity, are you saying that by 2028, 2029 there'll be £7 million a year or £7 million up until and including 2028, 2029?
In 2028, 2029, it will be £7 million.
Right, okay, so that's £7 million a year, effectively.
What I would note is that with these, it tends to be the case for the majority of claims for repayment of ADS, they tend to happen within 12 months, which is broadly similar to the equivalent taxes in England and Wales. So this is a matter that will sort of work its way through over the forecast period, and say that particular number of £7 million at the end of the forecast period. Yeah. So we'll, of course, we'll continue to monitor and indeed monitor both in terms of the revenue and, of course, the forecasts that the SFC produce going forward.
And, of course, the Scottish Police Authority, because it's important that they're able to provide housing, particularly in kind of rural island areas. Any idea how much it would relief would apply if, for example, they were brought in a future SSI? Has that not been calculated as yet?
I don't have that number, but I would say that I think the estate, the number of, sort of houses, hostels are covered by the police authority is far smaller, significantly smaller proportionally than, say, compared to local authorities of the overall property
Indeed.
Market. But again, as part of that engagement we have with the police authority, I'm more than happy to explore that further and update the committee in due course.
Just moving on to the Scottish Property Federation, they've said that tax legislation will really cover each and every eventuality, and given the potential high taxation burden of ADS, we continue to feel that a power to enable a relief for exceptional circumstances should be applied in the discretion of Revenue Scotland, and this would bring additional fairness. So, are they going to say this is something of a missed opportunity to address these wider concerns which we raise? I'm just wondering if that's your comments on that.
Two points that I would make. First, in terms of some of those circumstances which have given rise to the ask for an exceptional circumstances provision, we have sought to address through some of the specific amendments we make within the order. So that, in terms of reducing the ask for an exceptional circumstances provision, I think is important in response to some of these specific circumstances. More on the actual position of an exceptional circumstances discretionary power, it is something we gave consideration to, but the concern is around administrative complexity and uncertainty, particularly for Revenue Scotland as for taxpayers. So what we have sought to do through this order is address some of these specific concerns that have given cause for concerns to be raised about the way in which ADS had been operating previously. So that's why we've not pursued an exceptional circumstances provision, but rather have sought to have a targeted approach in addressing some of the particular issues that had arisen previously.
I mean, you talked about complexity, and that's one of the issues that's actually been raised by the Law Society of Scotland. What they've said is that the law relating to ADS is complex and nuanced. We do not consider that the amendments in and of themselves will simplify the law in this area, and in some cases may complicate the position for certain taxpayers depending on their circumstances. And I'm sure colleagues may wish to give examples of those which are in their paper. But what's your view on that? Because one would have thought that this would be the whole purpose of this was, you know, clarity and simplification, and yet the Law Society of Scotland appear to be of the view that the opposite is the case.
I recognise the complexity involved and the issues which ultimately led to the call for evidence and the consultation on these regulations speak to the complexity and the issues that arised, and I certainly received much correspondence from colleagues outlining concerns they had about the way in which ADS was operating, and that's why we took forward this piece of work which seeks to address these concerns. In terms of the regulations specifically, or the order specifically, and ahead of 1st of April, should Parliament agree to the order before us, Revenue Scotland will be producing clear and comprehensive guidance which will be shared in advance. My understanding is that Revenue Scotland has already shared their work on this with relevant stakeholders in tax, accountancy and law. And my understanding is also that Revenue Scotland intend to host a series of webinars again in advance of the 1st of April to ensure that sufficient information and guidance and awareness is provided around how the system will operate should these regulations be approved by Parliament.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. I'm going to open out the session now to colleagues. The first to ask questions will be Michelle, to follow by John.
Good morning, Minister. Just a couple of wee points. I think in general terms the changes to ADS in particular are welcome because there were, as we know, quite a few anomalies. I just wanted to check, it was a comment by the Chartered Institute of Taxation where somebody finds themselves in a position taking an inheritance of a property and then seeking to buy their own home. And there's been provision of relief made in the period between a property inherited and the conclusion of missives of a new property. The purchase of the new property, I should say. But the point is that missives are now invariably and concluding. It's been the case since about 2008, probably on the day of purchase. The days where you used to conclude missives and then purchase would take later have changed because of lack of availability of finance. So I just wanted to understand what you're thinking, because it seems like a relief that will get very little take up altogether, and therefore people are still going to continue to be impacted where they find, through no fault of their own and no choice, in the situation where they inherit a property but still need to buy their own family home. So it's just more context around that.
I think the first point I would want to make, as much as I made reference to having received correspondence from colleagues on the operation of ADS, the circumstances that overwhelmingly the system works as intended, it works effectively, it delivers, and it proves to be an important the whole system, an important source of revenue for the Scottish Government. So these measures that we're considering today are quite narrow, but perhaps will not affect a significant number of people, but they do respond to concerns that had been raised. So the point about it responding to maybe very sort of a unique set of circumstances is one I accept. What this particular provision seeks to cover is, and take the situation that, you know, missives and closure of transaction are happening almost simultaneously, then there isn't that window. But it is when there is that window between conclusion of missives and the effective transaction date, where someone were to inherit a property, and obviously remembering it's LBTT isn't biting on the actual inherited property, it would be someone coming into possession of a property and then purchasing another property after that. That would be a situation which is almost out with their control to some extent. So it seeks to provide a relief which I think it would say is fair and is reasonable. So I recognise that the situations where that actually might be of benefit might not be frequent, but for those who do find themselves in that situation, I think it helps in provide greater certainty and fairness within the system.
I mean, you make a fair point about the probability of occurrence in both scenarios. It's not going to be huge volumes, but when it does occur, it could potentially have quite a high impact on one person, which is why, following up on the convener's comment about having some kind of discretionary power for Revenue Scotland, which HMRC, because I think you're already conceding that there continue to be some scenarios that require further SSI and ironed out because just the nature of it. So I'm still a bit unclear why you wouldn't grant a discretionary power to Revenue Scotland I know you'll look for certainty in the law, and that's eminently sensible, but you yourself are considering that there continue to be some anomalies as we get to the detail of this, and having that discretionary power by Revenue Scotland would surely allow for ironing out these anomalies. And if HMRC, obviously they've got more resource, I understand that, but they can do that without there being continuing kind of legal cases. Why wouldn't Revenue Scotland be able to?
Standing us with HMRC, the discretion is really just to extend timelines. Now, I appreciate it's 36 months in England. One of the things we're doing through these regulations is extending to 36 months. On the point of whether or not there should be that discretionary power for Revenue Scotland, I think that is a conversation that we can explore. The point I would want to make is it would be quite a significant change from the way in which we operate at the moment, whereby Parliament legislates and Revenue Scotland provides the guidance. So it would be quite a significant change for Revenue Scotland, and recognising that HMRC operates under a different setup. So on that broader point, I think that's something that we can consider. It would require a lot more detailed consideration, a lot more exploration. But coming back to the point about how we've sought to address the issues that have been raised that have led to these this order coming before the committee, which is to having identified through consultation and engagement a number of those particular anomalies, seeking to address them directly in a targeted approach through the amendments that the order provides for.
Yeah. And my last point, I mean, I think I make a fair point, the Minister makes a fair point about that being a change, and it may be something, along with similar discussions we're having about a finance bill, that's worth considering at some point, because there are always unintended consequences with every tax, but there's also the complexity by shunting in Scottish taxes within some of the complexity of a wider UK framework that may lend itself to that. And I think that's a separate discussion, but that's probably all my points, Convener.
Okay, thank you. John has opted out, so it's going to be Liz to be followed by Jamie.
Thank you, Minister. I was very grateful to hear your comment that you are open to some further discussions about a finance bill. I just wondered, could you tell us, has that discussion been within your own portfolio, or has that gone further upscale to Cabinet?
It's the discussion that we have had previously, and I think much of the context was looking to recommence the work of the devolved taxes group that I know went into abeyance during the pandemic. The point I would come back to is it something that, you know, in government we're open to discussing further, but I think I appreciate I'm repeating myself here, but it's really important as that engagement with Parliament on the matter. If we were to move to that particular system and approach, I know it would it'd be a piece of work at this committee, I imagine, would ultimately have to lead on. So I'm conscious of that. So I am, as I say, more than happy, you know, to have further discussions on this. I know officials are happy to engage directly with the committee as well. But I appreciate there's a broader set of considerations to take into account in terms of the feasibility.
Thank you for that. It's just ICAS says in its contribution that, you know, historically we have found that, generally speaking, the awareness of the Scottish taxes is not high in Scotland. I think we know that. And there is a need for improvement in communications by the Scottish Government to ensure that that improves in line with the Scottish Government's own framework for tax principles. And obviously, we've heard quite a lot from Audit Scotland that there is a need for greater clarity and transparency about tax in general. You know, what decisions have underpinned certain tax decisions, where's the money coming from, etc. So I think the point that both the convener and Michelle Thompson raised is a valid one, that to get some extra clarity and transparency, the idea of a finance bill to try to improve that is quite appealing, I think, to this committee. I completely take your point about the scrutiny of that has to be by Parliament, not just by specific committees, but I think we would be quite grateful if that discussion could go a wee bit further.
More than happy to, and I'll ask for officials to engage directly with the committee following this meeting, and we can discuss how we can take that work forward.
My second point, you said in answer to the convener that you're not able to provide any timescales should any further amendments have to be adjusted. Do you have any thought that there might be a number of adjustments that have to be made, or are you reasonably content that should we pass this, that that's, you know, going to be effective in addressing most of the concerns that we've heard?
I think the previous conversation around a finance bill and a merits of it speaks to the fact that there will always be a need for care and maintenance, and we have to take decisions based upon the information we have at the present time. So from this perspective, yes, but of course recognising that inevitably other issues can emerge, other concerns can emerge in the future, and of course we would respond to that just as we have previously. Obviously this particular tax has seen quite a significant volume of legislation, both primary and secondary, and amendments since it was introduced. So we'll of course respond, and we'll seek to do so in a way that is as open and as transparent as possible through engagement. Regard to specific timelines around the issues that have been raised by the SPA, we will have that engagement with the authority, and I say more than happy to update the committee in due course as to where these conversations lead.
So just in relation to some of the concerns that have been put before us, the Scottish Government is going to have ongoing discussions with these groups individually about their concerns, or is today, should we pass it, the end of the matter for that discussion process?
No, I would not want to see describe this as the end of the matter. I think with all aspects of tax legislation, it's a process rather than just an event. So clearly there's been a number of issues raised. There's always a challenge in having to balance and appreciate there's competing demands, and not everyone can be satisfied without impacting upon another. But on those broader points around transparency, about the how user-friendly the presentation of legislation is, again touching on the point about an annual finance bill, I think these are very important points. We want a tax system that is as straightforward to use as possible, and understanding the importance of that as well in relation to economic growth and providing certainty. So in that spirit, very much keen to continue these conversations with, whether it be with public bodies and other authorities, or indeed with organisations like ICAS, CIOT, okay, and the Law Society.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Jamie.
Thank you very much. It's just a very quick point, maybe of clarification. I was really on the same lines as the convener's points on Police Scotland. Obviously, they've talked about the lack of exemption. As you'll be aware, housing and access to housing, and particularly in parts of my region, Highlands and Islands, is very difficult. There's a shortage, and there have been a lot more suggestions that public bodies should be or could be providing houses to ensure they can get the staff that they need, particularly in areas around the NHS. Can you just confirm, would the exemptions that Police Scotland are not entitled to, would NHS boards be entitled to those exemptions, or would NHS housing also
The exemptions that are set out within the schedule, they've been the amended schedule should the order be agreed, are specific to local authorities under the respective Housing Acts 87 and 88. As to the situation of other public bodies, I don't know if there's anything you want to comment on, Laura.
So I think as part of the review and the work around Police Scotland's submission, one thing the Scottish Government also wants and is seeking to understand is the impact on similar organisations such as the NHS, the Fire Service, for example. So it will be an all-encompassing.
I mean, the Fire Service is obviously a national body. NHS boards are local. So, I mean, are you aware that whether they'd be exempt at the moment? Or
my understanding is that they would not be, but I'm happy to go and clarify that point and write back to the committee. I think clearly that this conversation has explored a wider range of issues around exemptions for public bodies. Clearly, if local the question is, if local authorities are exempt, should other public bodies be exempt as well? Now, I think we could start going through every public body one by one. So what I'd suggest it would be helpful for the committee is to take this away, have further discussions, and obviously engaging with housing colleagues and Housing Minister, and write back to the committee just to provide a broader overview of what the current landscape is and provide clarity on the point you raise, and also to set out the work it will be doing to develop policy in this area.
Yeah, I mean, that would be very helpful. As I say, for a lot of particularly NHS boards that I speak to in my region, staff shortages, how access to housing is a big part of that. So it's just how that would fit in encouraging or supporting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That appears to have exhausted questions from the committee. And Ross, you're just here to vote, in time to vote if necessary.
To forward some flooded roads this morning, but it took longer than I think the driver expected it would.
Okay, thank you. So we now turn to agenda item 2, which involves formal consideration of the motion on the instrument. I invite the Minister to speak to and move S6M 11928 that the Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Order 2024 draft be approved.
Formally moved.
Do any members wish to speak? I now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M 11928 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I thank the Minister and Laura Parker for their evidence today. We'll publish a short report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the draft order in due course. I now suspend the meeting briefly to allow for a change of witnesses before we move on to the next agenda item. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Scottish Government Bill Team in relation to the Financial Memorandum for the Agriculture and Rural Communities of Scotland Bill. For this session, we are joined by Scottish Government officials, John Kerr, Deputy Director, Agriculture, Rural Policy Division, Mandy Callaghan, Deputy Director, Agriculture and Land Transition, Karen Morley, Head of Finance, Agriculture and Rural Economy Directorate, and Ewan Scott, Branch Head, Agriculture Bill, Scottish Government. I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting. I'd also like to thank you for coming in early. Our previous item finished a lot sooner than we had anticipated, so apologies for rushing you in a wee bit earlier than scheduled. But I now invite Mr. John Kerr to make a brief opening statement. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. It's actually you, and the Bill Team Leader, who's going to give the opening statement, if that's okay with you.
No, that's absolutely fine. Okay, Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Convener. So as Bill Lead, I'm coordinating a coordination team for the Agricultural and Rural Communities Bill. So I've got here today with me a couple of lead contributors to the financial memo. So just quick background on this bill. On the 28th of September, the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill was introduced to Parliament, as you'll know. The bill seeks the powers to deliver upon the Scottish Government's vision for agriculture, which was published in March 2022. The objectives of the bill, seeks to be the platform for measures that focus on the Scottish Government's key outcomes, which are high-quality food production, climate mitigation and adaptation, nature restoration, and wider rural development. So collectively, this seeks to form a framework of support for agriculture, forestry, and rural communities, and more generally. The powers sought in the bill deliver upon the broader outcomes of the aforementioned vision for agriculture. The powers also sought to enable outcomes related to forestry, food and drink, and rural communities and economy. In addition, it also provides the opportunity to modernise the powers of the Scottish ministers on areas relating to animal health and welfare. Animal health and identification, welfare and plant health, and safeguard agriculture genetic resources of plants and animals. To support the delivery of the vision for agriculture, a new four-tiered support framework is being proposed. The bill provides the powers to deliver this four-tiered support. The primary framework does not provide the detail, as that would be restrictive and fail to provide the flexibility to respond to the change. The details of the tiered framework will therefore be provided in secondary legislation. Over the past 2 to 3 years, we've been building on the outputs of the farmer-led groups, the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, or AREOB as it's known, which has supported and informed the development of the consultation and the proposals in the bill to replace the current CAP framework for agriculture and land use support. We ran a public consultation on the bill from the 29th of August until the 5th of December, in which we had 392 valid responses received, in addition to a wide range of feedback from approximately 600 attendees of 9 in-person events and 5 online events. Going forward, ministers are committed to working closely with stakeholders using the established co-production approach to developing future policy. The intention is for the published four-tier support framework to continue to be developed with this co-development and detailed measures with partners. Whilst the bill does not provide financial details on the four-tier system, it is intended that such a tier system will be utilised in the future. The costings have been provided on that basis in the financial memo. With lead input from ARP and finance team, the finance memo makes reference to the existing budget support levels that are provided for under the current Common Agriculture Policy and its associated support structure. Forecasting has been provided for the future support framework budgets against existing Common Agriculture Pillars 1 and 2 and forestry grant budget allocations, alongside other financial support provided to the sector that have also forecast from the enhancement of the bill. In addition to this, costings have been provided on existing Scottish administration alongside best available forecast transition costs to deliver a future support framework that can be made at this stage. The memo also sets out working financial assumptions for future programme against its proposed four tiers, which are based on the continuation of funding at the quantum hereafter available to Scotland through EU CAP budgets. As the bill is a framework bill, which provides the future flexibility and adaptivity on how ministers may wish to provide support in the future, At this stage, forecasting of a replacement programme is undertaken at a high level. However, future budget allocations are dependent on UK government funding commitments, which are uncertain. We'd be happy to answer any questions the committee may have. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that opening statement, which is very helpful. And most of my questions will be on the actual financial memorandum itself, as opposed to the submissions we've received, although we'll touch on those as well. And indeed, some of the submissions have informed the questions that I will be kind of asking. First one is in regarding the future support framework. Well, I mean, Mr. Scott, you touched on the fact that the bill doesn't provide details of the four-tier system. It's envisaged that such a tier system we utilise in the future, and costing is provided on this basis. And you go on to talk about the mechanism providing a level of continuity, but at the same time, you're looking at flexibility. One or two of our submissions have said that there's a kind of contradiction in that.
Maybe just bring John in.
Yeah, so thank you, Ewan. Thank you, convener. The bill sets out to provide the powers to enable us to take a flexible approach in due course, or at least to be framed around the ability for future ministers to take different decisions. So we've set out the way that we intend to use the four-tier framework within the powers of the bill. And we've also set out that we anticipate providing a similar level of support subject to the availability of funding, which Ewan mentioned in his opening statement from the UK government, with no cliff edges for producers. So we've got the flexibility to transition, but we also have the ability to do that over a period of time to provide that continuity. So rather than there being a contradiction in those two things, it's being able to do the flexibility over time, but introduce that in a way that is at the right pace for the industry to be able to come with us.
But yes, I mean, in paragraph 15, you've said that it'll provide a platform to build momentum for private sector green finance investment, but offering financial support explicitly linked to action for nature and action for climate on farms and crofts. We shouldn't turn give the land manager confidence to engage with private market investment in future, in nature. But the a lot of the submissions are saying, in actual fact, that what this financial memorandum does is bed invested interest in the status quo. So, for example, we've received a number of submissions. RSPB is the one in front of me, but four or five are almost the same, which says that the bottom 40% of recipients only receive 4.8% of the budget, i.e. the larger businesses get most of the income support. And if we look at LFA payments, they're not connected in any meaningful way to income and profitability. Farm business income data suggests, for example, only 23% of LFA, less favoured areas, cattle business have an income greater than zero without support payments, and compared to 82% of general cropping farms, for example, which make a profit without support. So one could suggest that, you know, this bill basically continues with the status quo whereby LFA payments are made on land rather than what's actually happening kind of really on that land in terms of achieving some of the objectives which the bill supposedly intends to achieve.
So it's true to say that the current system is based on area-based payments, which means that those with more land receive larger payments, slightly complicated by the fact that we divide our land into three different payment regions. So arable or improved land has the highest payment rate, so cropping farms, as you mentioned, would receive the highest rate per hectare, whereas the most extensively grazed parts of rough grazing in Scotland receive a much lower rate, so even quite large areas of land may receive a relatively small payment. And then the LFAS scheme works slightly independently of the three regions. But it is the case that there are a large number of small farms which therefore receive proportionately smaller amount of payment each and in total. And of course the bill provides us with the powers to look at whether or not we should have an upper threshold on the payments received by any one business according to whatever criteria we might want to set out or ministers might want to set out in future, including a cap on the total total amount of the payment. So there is the ability to move away from the current system rather than bed it in. And ministers have set out their wish to do that in a measured way so as to prevent no cliff edges to any particular businesses or in general. So we have, I don't think there's a contradiction between those two things, and it's a matter for future ministerial decisions at the pace at which we seek to transition.
Okay, I mean, in terms of financial memorandum, what it makes clear is almost that the money that will be actually available for financial support to the sector is going to be in tablets of stone, so that in 23-24, right through to 27-28, you're looking at exactly the same funding levels, so £741.9 million. Now, clearly this financial memorandum is already out of date, because what we've seen is in the current financial year, the actual funding, according to page 94 of the Scottish Budget, 24-25, is £738.9 million, and that drops to £705.7 million. So that's a 4.5% decrease. So does that not kind of knock a wee bit of a hole in the financial memorandum? And specifically, on page 96 of the Scottish Budget, if we look at the money for Woodland Grants Initiative, it's been raised in the Chamber on several occasions. Again, you're looking to hold the amount of money that's being invested in that area at £77.2 million, which is the current figure this year. But in next year's budget, it's already looking at a decline to £45.4 million, which is quite a considerable decline. So how can we kind of have faith in the figures going forward over a period of 5 years, when in the budget that we're about to vote on over the next, this month in fact, there's already significant changes to these to the sums in this memorandum.
So it's absolutely correct to say that the figures published in the financial memorandum were based on the best forecast that we could make at the time, which was in September, which is when it was submitted to the Parliament, which of course was in advance of the current budget process. As you say, the budget itself is currently going through the Parliament. So it would be to update the finance memo at this time would be not the right thing to do until we see the outcome of the budget process. But it is also true to say that ministers across government have had to make challenging decisions, which they've stated publicly in terms of the budget allocation. And so the forward cast of the 23-24 budget was the best basis on which to produce the financial memorandum, which is what Ewan set out in his opening remarks. So that was the best available information to officials at the time. And of course, the budget position has shifted since then. And so there are, in some of the lines, the budget lines that are mentioned in the financial memo, there have been movements, including the forestry grant scheme one that the convener mentions. So that is all the case. Nevertheless, the intention is for Scottish Government to continue to support the sector with the funds available, which until the end of the UK Parliament are to be retained at much the quantum that they are at present, and thereafter we don't know, because that will be that will be subject to Treasury decisions beyond the next UK election.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a matter of real concern. I mean, in paragraph 23, you've said, and it's already been touched on by Mr Scott, that EU exit means Scotland no longer has long-term certainty of funding. HM Treasury has provided yearly allocations for the current UK parliamentary term. However, there's no funding commitment from 2025, and it requires funding certainty. So given the fact that there has been no commitment beyond 2025 this parliamentary term, where are we in terms of providing some certainty through this financial memorandum for Scotland and this bill for our agricultural sector? Because we've already seen a knock the next financial year. What's the kind of likelihood that that will be exacerbated further? I mean, I know you've not got a crystal ball, but what's your concerns on that, and what's the likely parameters? Should we not see a commitment beyond 2025?
So I think to set out at the outset, I think it's important that we remember that the bill here is to provide Scottish ministers and the Scottish Government with the appropriate powers to support the sector and achieve the objectives that are set out in the purposes in the bill. But it doesn't set the budget. The budget is set through the budget setting process. And I suppose so that, and that principally requires us to reach a settlement across agriculture in the UK in terms of all the devolved administrations or the UK administrations receiving an appropriate level of funding for the agriculture and land-based sector in terms of support. The Bew Review explicitly recommended that there be a revised settlement across the four administrations to take account of what the policy is currently trying to deliver across all of the administrations in the UK, not just in Scotland. And to date, we haven't had any meaningful discussion with Treasury and the other administrations, though we continue to seek those discussions with our counterparts across the other three countries. And indeed, some of our colleagues in the other administrations are doing likewise with Treasury. Nevertheless, we are where we are, and we can only continue to press as we are doing.
Okay, thank you. Now, the National Farmers Union seems to be fairly happy with the financial memorandum, for example, but other organisations such as Land Workers Alliance are unhappy, stating that the continuation of area-based direct payments constitutes, and I quote, an unacceptable use of public funds. And as I've talked earlier on about, it is a maintenance of the status quo and one could argue vested interest. So what discussions is the Scottish Government having with organisations, some of whom feel they weren't actively consulted by the Scottish Government, in terms of looking at how we can deliver the best possible outcome in Scotland's agriculture and rural communities in terms of what the Scottish Government's objectives are?
So, as Ewan set out earlier on, we've undertaken a broad consultation, both a Scottish Government consultation, and we also sought the help of Nourish Scotland to do a more community-focused round of consultation discussions. So that was a public offering and people did participate. We had good participation across the consultations. And we also have individually met with stakeholder bodies, including the Land Workers Alliance, which you discussed, who actually held a rally outside this building. And we met with them at that time and separately to hear their concerns. They would like to see more support for small producers and small enterprises, which can often supply quite significant quantities of food from quite small areas. And that forms the basis of their critique of an area-based system. And we recognise that, and indeed we are running a small producers pilot scheme to assess how we better assist those producers using smaller businesses, which would include those in the Crofton counties with polytunnels, that sort of thing. So we do have support available to small producers at present. You don't have to be a large producer to access the support available from the Scottish Government currently, but we do recognise that there is potentially more that we could do there, and we are currently piloting that. And the powers within the bill would provide for more of that type of support to be rolled out in future, should ministers so choose.
I mean, the RSPB has around 83,000 hectares of land, and much of it, of course, has got agriculture activities on it. And they've said that historically, the Common Agricultural Policy has performed poorly in terms of directing spending appropriately and offered best value for money. And what they've talked about is, if we go forward, we should really be looking at cost benefits. You know, and what they're saying is that, you know, that there's not really been any alternative approaches. And they've seen nothing from the Scottish Government that suggests cost-benefit analysis of a range of reform options has ever been undertaken. So again, it's, as I've mentioned a couple of times, it looks like a steady-as-she-goes kind of financial memorandum, rather than looking at, well, we've got an opportunity to make a significant changes here. Let's look at where we get the best value for money. So has what work's been undertaken that to see that we're getting the best bang for our agricultural buck, given the kind of commitments that we need to fulfil in the years ahead, not least on climate?
So the thing that we set out in our that we set out in parallel with the bill process itself is our four-tiered structure that is proposed to be implemented by the powers in the bill and secondary legislation which will follow. And that sets out that we will continue with a base payment system similar to what we have at the moment, with some of the basic payment scheme budget attached to it. But we then also intend to bring in a second tier structure where we will, for everyone will have access, every farmer and crofter should have access to that money if they wish to undertake the measures that are set out in that second tier. And that's where we anticipate that the lion's share of the work will be done in terms of climate and nature outcomes, while still, of course, supporting food producers who are managing the land, but to get those additional outcomes, which is new. So that is something which will be different to what we have at present, and it will be broad-reaching. So it will be different to our current agri-environment support in the sense that that's more targeted with a limited budget. So the second tier of our framework is where we anticipate the benefits being realised. We're currently going through the development work of that, and very much at the heart of that is establishing which interventions will deliver the most value in terms of reducing emissions and promoting on-farm nature recovery and restoration. So, and that work is ongoing, and the third element of that will be having the right monitoring and evaluation sitting behind it, so that we can check as we go that we are getting the right bang for our buck, as you put it.
So what do you say to comment that, and I quote, we do not see the logic of area-based payments, payments which do little more than reward land ownership and inflate land values?
So there is a criticism that, which is valid about the area-based support system, which it doesn't closely link to the agricultural output. Mm-hmm. An output-based subsidy is would be a WTO amber box thing. So we've stepped away from that, and the European Union absolutely wanted to decouple the link with productivity so as to prevent perverse incentives of overstocking and overproduction. So that's why we've got to the position that we've evolved to today. But going forward, if we want to deliver more benefit, then it is also true that some of those benefits scale with the land that the benefits are delivered across. So if you want to restore riparian woodland, for example, mm-hmm. if you're a large estate, you've got more potential to deliver more of that value to the public. So it does make sense that some of our support should be linked to the area that those interventions are delivered across, because they scale with it. Similarly, if you want to reduce emissions from the beef herd, then the largest producers have potentially got the most to contribute there in terms of emissions reduction. So it is true that we would want to keep some of that link with scale, because we want to deliver some of those public benefits at scale too.
Okay. One of the issues that's come up is the cost of administration. So in paragraph 47 of the financial memorandum, it says, and I quote, the 23-24 budget cost to administer payment compliance and supporting services is £61 million. This represents approximately 11% of the £692 million budget for all current schemes. My arithmetic says under 9% out of that was £61 million, so there's a wee error there, I think. But more importantly, in terms of the issue, future administrative costs under the proposed future framework support are currently unclear and will depend on the chosen delivery model. I mean, £61 million is a lot of money for administration. So I wonder if you can perhaps fill us in on what that £61 million would be spent on specifically. I mean, and why, you know, it's unclear.
Well, the £61 million is the combination of the IT and ARPED, so the whole IT system that sits behind it, and what we call the paying agency, the ARPED staff that administer and support farmers to go through that process. As part of the programme of work supporting a transition away from where we are at the moment to fulfilling the framework and delivering a more flexible process that can respond to the future in a way that the current structures are very settled, I suppose, is developing a business case that sets out the different options for operational delivery. So that 61 million has been built up over a number of years, different schemes added at different times, so all of those things have to be administered, as has been done through the EU. So we're looking now at what are the operational delivery options, something that, you know, may be more streamlined and simpler to administer. We haven't gone through all of those options yet, and that's part of the work that we're doing at the moment in developing the business case for how operational delivery will work under the new framework and following this bill.
So how did you come to the figure of 61 million then, given there's so much that's unclear and is still being worked on?
Well, those costs are the current administration, so it's the costs of the IT, and there's a lot of support in the IT systems because there's a number of different systems that support that. We have the staffing costs across ARPID, the regional offices, those kind of things. So it's kind of a total cost at the moment.
I appreciate it, basically, but again, it seems to be steady as she goes. Is there no thought towards how that administration cost can perhaps be reduced so that, for example, more money can be actually invested in agriculture directly itself and in innovation and in climate reduction things? I mean, it seems to me this is an excellent opportunity to actually make changes to reduce bureaucracy and improve efficiency and delivery. So I'm a bit disappointed that we just said, well, do you know what, we'll just keep the money the same. There doesn't seem to be any ambition to try and reduce that even by 5, 10, 15, 20%. And as we've seen, the overall budget in next financial year is looking at a 4.5% reduction, and yet there doesn't seem to be any consideration here for a reduction in admin.
So there is work going on doing exactly that with the current. So it's that point about building the ship while building the plane while we're flying it. So there are efficiencies being made within those processes now, but what we haven't yet got is the structure of what the future administration will look like. It would be the intention for that to be more efficient than it is at the moment.
So when will we have that? I mean, it seems to me, we're in a kind of groundhog day in this committee whereby we keep getting these financial memorandums. I know this is only one that's your responsibility. So do apologise for this generalised moan, but generally we're getting these framework bills where we're always having to ask questions about future resources and how they're going to be funded, what the secondary legislation is going to look like. So when are we going to be in a position whereby the issues in relation to administration are no longer, to quote your own financial memorandum, unclear?
Well, we're working through the business case at the moment, so
Well, I know, a game lasts 90 minutes, how long is a piece of string, but is there a date being set when this is going to be resolved, or is this going to be one of these things just meanders on for weeks, months, possibly years?
So I think it's important to recognise that the future delivery costs will be dependent on what types of support ministers at any given moment choose to take forward. So one of the issues that we have to wrestle with is that the more we want to accommodate each particular type of agriculture, the more detailed and complex the policy and then the delivery needs to be, but that complexity then attracts cost. So there'll be a point at which we have to take a decision. Ministers ultimately will have to take a decision about how much complexity do we want in order to accommodate different types of businesses, and how much and where do we want to stop doing that in order to make the delivery costs reasonable for the total amount of public benefit you'll get for each change. And we're working through that process, and what we've committed to do rightly is to work with the sector to establish what is possible in terms of getting the right measures in all the tiers, and then we have to take a view about what the delivery implications of that are, and then come to a position about what the final settled policy would be. And that process is still ongoing and will continue to be ongoing as we work through the transition, and we envisage that taking well, our published route map goes to 2027 and beyond. So some of these questions won't be known for some time to come.
So it's a kind of permanent revolution that we're in, then?
So it's a permanent state of improvement would be perhaps a better way to put it from my perspective.
Indeed, indeed. Just that revolution, you know, evokes chaos and stuff like that, and I'm concerned that, you know, I always think if you've got a goal and a task, you know, it's a lot easier to reach, and if you don't have a goal and a task with a deadline, then it's a lot harder to reach because there's never any kind of date at which there has to be a delivery. Okay, I'll allow others to come in now. The first member to come in with questions is Jamie, to follow by Ross.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I just remind committee of my register of interest as a partner in a farming business and a member of the Royal Highland Agricultural Society, SLE and NFUS as well. Just on that point that the convener's making, and I think it's, as he said, it's a frustration for all of us that we get framework bills and there's a lot of talk about co-design and that things are going to change, but that makes it extremely difficult to know exactly how we're scrutinising. Just to kind of clarify, the tier system that you operate at the moment, the plans are for four tiers. Some of those tiers will be more costly, I imagine, to administer and to, you know, for example, tier two requires perhaps more monitoring and evaluation than tier one. So when do you think you'll get an idea of, firstly, the structure and the emphasis put on each tier?
In the route map, we set out that we intend to introduce the first iteration of the Tier 2 support in 2026. So we should be, and we are, working towards getting the shape of that ready to then talk to farmers about it in the coming, you know, 6 to 8, 12 months, let's say. There's quite a lot of work to be done there, hence my slight hesitancy around that. But that our current plan is to have that in place by 2026 with guidance available to farmers in advance of that. And at that point, we should have a good sense of what the delivery costs are tier.
Is tier two the one tier that is possibly has most variable costs associated with it?
Not necessarily. I think it's the piece of our policy that's the most new and different from where we are presently, depending on how we implement it. Whereas the other tiers, we have a reasonably established current approach, which will be relatively similar, albeit there are room, as Mandy has said, to hopefully simplify and reduce some of the administrative burden of that, both for our point of view as the paying agency and also towards farmers. So it's that second tier is the one where we see the greatest uncertainty, though at this right at this moment we're trying to narrow that down to something much more controlled and known.
Okay, at the Rural Affairs Committee last week, Professor Thompson of the Scottish Rural College said a rural support plan needs to be front and centre. Douglas Bell of Scottish Tenant Farmers Association said the earlier that, and referring to a rural support plan, the earlier that can come, the better. There is a real frustration of agricultural stakeholders just now about working in a vacuum. The UK government were able to provide a clarity in terms of their vision for agriculture and a UK agriculture bill back in 2021. We're left with a framework bill and an approach that the DPLR said was poses difficulties for scrutiny. Would you agree with that? And why haven't we able to get a clearer vision already, if we're not going to be getting anything till 2025?
So I think it's right that the rural support plan will be an important document for the industry to be able to plan from. However, I would also say that we have set out the Scottish Government's vision for agriculture really clearly in terms of what the objectives are, and they're also set out on the face of the bill.
The objectives aren't the plan. And therefore, as a committee that has to look at the cost implications, we're looking at aims and objectives rather than actual plans.
So that is right. But the other thing that we've done, and I think it's important, is that we've set out the vision for our four-tiered structure of payments. We've also set out the timeline under which we expect to implement those. Now, as I said earlier, it's difficult for us as officials to plan for future budgets that are uncertain. So the industry would like to have that certainty for budget planning purposes, and the Scottish Government agrees with that and continues to press for that clarity. I think it's important to remember that agriculture has come from a place where the European Union's process was to have a 7-year programme, so a funding envelope which lasted across that period, and there was flexibility to use that money, and anything that wasn't paid out early in the process could be paid out later in the process. And that has currently gone from UK agriculture, that type of support. So that planning element, we share some of the frustrations of the industry around that. But I think we've been as clear as we can be while still committing to that spirit of co-development with the industry of what the individual measures within each tier should be. So we are balancing those two pressures.
I mean, I take that on board, but I mean, still, the actual plan for agricultural rural support plan will be 5 years later than it's taken, say, the UK government to deliver it. And it is important for knowing what the costs are.
So I would say that we've been really clear with the industry about where we currently are, where we're going to be shortly, and our long-term vision. Mm-hmm. So I would dispute that we're in anything other than as good a place as farmers south of the border.
Okay. I mean, just last point on this section, on this area. DPLR committee has asked that you consider publishing a rural support plan before stage three.
So, colleagues are working very hard on many aspects of this, so I'm reluctant to tie our hands. And in any case, it would be for ministers to decide when we bring that forward. As I say, I think that the vision for agriculture combined with our route map is 9/10 of our plan. Mm-hmm. And some of the extra elements that will go into that are under development right now.
Okay. So I'm just for clarity's purposes, you're not ruling that out, but do you think it's unlikely?
Well, I wouldn't. It's not really for me to say. That would be for ministers to commit to.
Okay. Just looking at some of the other kind of areas, I just want to get a bit of an idea. Within the current system and also within the framework bill, when you say it, what will happen to underspend on a yearly basis? Will that have to remain within the sector, or could you see that being, can that go in and out of the budget as it does now?
So as I mentioned a moment ago, previously the European Union cap had a specific mechanism for us to be able to draw down monies flexibly across, particularly the Pillar 2 part of the former EU programme, and that situation has gone. In terms of the financial arrangements, perhaps I would defer to Karen to say something about that.
Thanks, John. So it's true that the Scottish Government has taken underspends from the budgets in year to meet other pressures across the Scottish Government. The commitment to return that funding to the sector in future is purely one that ministers have taken within the Scottish Government. It's not linked to anything related to the Westminster funding. And it recognises that the overarching difficult position that the Scottish Government has had to try and manage. That's all been discussed in the public domain through Parliament questions as well, so I'm not really going to get any further into that. But as long as we have single-year budgets, we should expect to live within each annual settlement and the prospect of deferring funding into a future year should be done from the perspective of a planned future commitment rather than an emerging underspend that creates a liability in the next year. And unfortunately, that's just the constraints that we're working with annual budgets. Whether there's any appetite to change or opportunity for ministers to change within the Scottish budget perspective to give multi-year funding, I don't know. But we plan across multi-years for administrative purposes, but we can only deliver bound within the constraints of the annual budget setting that we have.
But obviously, yeah, I mean, I appreciate that, but obviously at the moment, money can come out of the budget and it can or can be withheld and used elsewhere. And promises from politicians, I'm sure they're, if I take my politician's hat off and put my kind of farmer's hat on, they're not always worth a huge amount. So there's nothing within this approach, because we always look at the kind of additional cost of legislation, but there could be areas where, depending on how decisions are taken to as part of the filling out of the framework, there could be areas where underspend can still be utilised out with the agriculture budget.
That's the ministerial priority, and as it has, as we've seen this year, yes.
Okay.
And as a part of the administration, we are duty bound to not sit on pots of money that we can't spend when other parts of the administration are really struggling. I mean, we've got to be fair to our colleagues on that a little bit, I think, as well. But we do plan for delivering within the remit of what our ministers are asking us to deliver.
Okay.
As best we can.
Thank you. Two other brief kind of areas. One was around EU alignment. The EU plan, which I think, as you said, the new plan is 7 years. It's going to see, as we're seeing from protests across Europe, it's going to see budgets cut. Obviously, this is an opportunity in the Scottish context to look for a new plan for Scotland. I take it our EU alignment isn't going to go as far as that.
So in taking the powers or seeking the powers, we've set out to align with the outcomes that the European policy also wants to reach. So really clear about wanting to maintain food production, we're really clear about wanting to deliver on environmental goals, and we're really clear about wanting to continue to support thriving rural communities. And that broadly is in line with what the European Union wants to do as well. You mentioned that the protests in different European countries, and currently France is in the most obvious of those, and I think their farmers are not so much. So it's a complex picture, mm-hmm. where they're, but principally they're protesting about the lack of market return, mm-hmm. for the type of farming that European citizens want to see their farmers undertaking, and that's partly policy driven and partly market standards driven, and it's not only about the support payments, which is what the bill more or less talks about, okay. but also some of the conditions attached to that in terms of environmental performance and. Farmers in Europe seeing it as we're doing all this hard work and then consumers go to the supermarket and buy something from a country.
Okay,
just lastly
on that EU alignment point, the new cap scheme, I understand, requires reserves to be kept for crises, as kind of some of the issues that we've seen. Is that something that would be built into this or envisaged for this legislation when the framework is kind of fleshed out? And if so, how would that reserve be built up?
So the crisis reserve is much more meaningful when you're 28 member states and you can amount a reasonably large reserve. Mm-hmm. Smaller countries have much less ability to deal with a crisis in perhaps one small territory from the 28 member states. So whether or not we can meaningfully put together a crisis reserve that would help is a point that
it's not being considered though at the moment.
Yeah, so, but it is a point that we have considered,
right.
And I would need to just check, but I think it is in the bill.
Yeah. Just to comment on that, there are powers within the proposed bill that would enable us to utilise funds in that manner.
And how would that be funded, and what would you envisage that to be?
The bill is silent on that, but there's a flexibility, and I think that would be for ministers to decide.
So there could be money being taken out of the agricultural body to hold in reserves. Those reserves would be only for agriculture use. Could they be utilised again out with that budget line?
So, as I said, the bill isn't drawn on that, and that's a decision that would be for ministers to make in due course.
Right. You can appreciate why we're being asked to make a decision on the financial memorandum of the bill, and there's a lot of uncertainty here. On how the money, what we all appreciate is limited, is going to be used.
Yeah, I think it's the reason that I preface my answer with the situation in Europe with the crisis reserve is because it's really important that the context is right. Because if, as you pointing out, we've got a reasonably modest Scotland-sized budget to support. If we have a significant crisis, then finding the money from that budget is going to take it from other recipients. And it's not the intention for us to have to do that. But, whenever you're facing a crisis, you have to treat it on its merits at the time. So that would be a decision for ministers. But what we have done and what's important is that we've taken the powers to enable ministers to support the sector in a time of crisis, as we did this year in terms of repairing flood banks. So we've made sure to have the powers to allow ministers to provide that support. The finding of the money is a slightly separate issue, albeit the one that you're focused on here.
Quite an important issue, though.
Yes.
OK, Queen, I'll pass back now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ross, before by John.
Thanks. Excuse me. Try that again. Thanks, Convener. I'd like to just get a little bit of clarity on some of the stuff that the Convener touched on in his original line of questioning around the balance of funding allocation between Tier 1 and Tier 2 and above. If you look through the consultation, the evidence submitted to the committee, but also consultation responses, I think it's fair to say a number of the organisations who have submitted evidence to us have made an assumption about that and objected to it, and others have stated that they felt it was ambiguous. So just for clarity, the financial memorandum, I think it's paragraph 21, and I'll be paraphrasing slightly, says, in broad terms, the government intends to maintain underpinning support through brace payments, Tier 1, and universally accessible support for land managers undertaking climate and nature actions through the enhanced mechanism, Tier 2, and to do so at similar levels to current direct support. Some of the organisations who have submitted evidence to us have read that in two different ways. So some folk have read it as the individual payments will be roughly similar to the level of payment that they are now, with new conditions, capping potentially, etc. Others have read it as the overall balance of budget allocation between the amount of money given to Tier 1 and the amount of money given to Tier 2 and above will stay roughly as it is at the moment. Could you just clarify which of those readings is correct?
So, I can't, because that's subject to future decisions of ministers. So it will be for ministers to decide what the split of the budget is between the four tiers in due course. We hope to set that out clearly for businesses in the run-up to the implementation of the 2026 iteration of the scheme, when we hope to bring in Tier 2. What we set out in the bill consultation was that we anticipated that the levels in Tiers 1 and 2, which are the reaches everybody support, everybody who wants to participate, would be broadly similar to what we currently have in the income support part of our current policy, at least at the early part of the transition, because ministers have committed to no cliff edges, which in order to meet that, we would want to not drastically reduce anybody's access to the payments that they currently receive, though that may change over time. And we have also been really clear that we expect businesses to be doing more for that money because of the Tier 2 element of that requiring more specific outcomes for nature and for climate of those that are producing our food. So we've set out that we broadly anticipate at the start of the process with the income support element of the budget, Tiers 1 and 2 being similar to what it is now, which would be BPS greening and possibly the LFAS payment.
You point out that... Sorry, that was useful overall. Thank you.
Support.
You point out that Tier 2 has more of the conditionality around climate, nature, restoration, etc. But, correct me if I'm wrong, at the moment, the vast majority of funding goes through Tier 1, which is largely unconditioned. So the tension here that's come out in a lot of the evidence submitted to us is, how do you square this circle between the ministerial commitment that you mentioned around no cliff edge with other ministerial commitments to for a transformation in agriculture, that's what's in the vision statement, the statutory targets that we've got around climate and emissions reduction, the statutory targets we're soon going to have around nature? It seems very hard for me to square what's in this FM and the bill with other commitments that ministers have made and other legislative commitments that are already in place, because certainly at least in the short to medium term, there's not going to be a significant shift in funding here, and therefore what's proposed here is not going to result in that shift towards lower emissions, more restoration of nature, etc., that the government's already committed to and that Parliament has already put in law.
So to a couple of points to pick up there. First of all, basic payments are conditioned. So at the moment, in order to receive a basic payment, so any form of income support, farmers have to comply with good agricultural and environmental condition, the GEEC rules, and they also have to abide by statutory management requirements. And so those are meaningful things that prevent harms happening in the environment. and underpin the conditions. And
they don't, so, sorry to cut across, you've got to acknowledge that they don't improve the situation. Where we are at the moment is Scotland is a massively ecologically degraded country with significant net contribution to global climate change. We recognise something needs to change. It's not really good enough to say that the basic payments at the moment are conditioned on not making things much worse, because the status quo, we've all agreed, Parliament's agreed, government's agreed, the sector's agreed, the status quo isn't good enough. So the conditions for the basic payments, that doesn't really fly, does it?
So I think it's fair to say that, that the farmers that would be that talk to us recognise those conditions as being meaningful. But your point about needing to make improvements is right, and that is why we've got the tier two of our proposed framework. It's going to deliver more of the environmental benefits that are needed. And you're right that the farming sector also recognises that they are needed and they want to contribute to that. So that's where the budget will make more difference than the current income support budget does. So at the moment we do have a greening policy which largely impacts on the arable and improved land, but it doesn't reach all of the grazed land, so that rougher grazing. So there is room for us to bring in more conditions for all farmers, but in particular those ones that are not caught by our current greening policy in tier two. And that's where we see that improvement being driven by that part of the policy.
But at the moment, there's no current intention for tier two to become a larger share of the overall budget. So as you've laid out, tier one, essentially, for the purposes of this conversation, tier one prevents things from getting worse. There's conditions in there to prevent further environmental degradation, but it's not about improvement as such. Tier two is about improvement, but what we've got in front of us doesn't give any indication that tier two is going to become a larger share of the overall budget.
So at the moment, for the sake of argument, if we put the greening conditions into what's currently income support in tier one, and then we introduce a new tier two, and take some of the current income support budget and put it into that tier two, then that will take some of the budget that's currently just got the current conditions and put it into this entirely new platform, which will then drive the changes. That's what our policy is predicated on. So it essentially takes the existing money and gets it to do more than it's currently doing.
Okay, that's useful. I think you can see the challenge for us, though, going back to what the convener said, of those decisions will all be made at a much later date. They're not what we are looking at now, but we are being asked to scrutinise what's in front of us. The challenge I've got is what I'm looking at in front of me doesn't give me any confidence, because it leaves a kind of blank space in this area that this bill and the government's financial assumptions around it will actually contribute towards statutory climate targets that we already have, never mind the nature targets that we're likely going to put in statute, the policy objectives the government's got, etc. How have you gone about engaging with the government team who are leading on the development of the climate plan, for example, to make sure that this bill is pointed in the same direction as statutory climate targets in the Act, but the plan that's being produced for later this year?
So I'm glad you asked the question that way. So I have, in my division, we have a group of staff whose function it is to ensure that the agriculture policy is aligned to the climate change plan. And indeed, the work that will go into the future climate change plan for the agriculture sector is being worked up by my team. And that team are then working with the Agricultural Reform Programme to ensure that we've got an implementable mechanism to take that forward in the support structure. And some of those new conditions, will come forward in advance of the bill powers in 2025. So we'll use existing powers to bring forward new conditions which help to tackle the climate crisis specifically. So we anticipate bringing forward new conditions for the circular beef support scheme in order to try and reduce emissions from that sector, and also some underpinning elements across all of agriculture to help get businesses ready to baseline their activities. Many of them are already doing that, but we intend to bring that in as a condition for everyone in order to tackle exactly the challenges that you're raising, so both on nature and on climate.
Thanks. And just finally, it's just been very useful. Have you had exactly this kind of conversation with all the organisations? So I'm sure you've engaged with throughout the bill process, but the likes of RSPB, Nourish, the Land Workers Alliance, who've all given incredibly similar submissions to the committee on exactly this point. Have you already started engaging them in a discussion to explain? Because in some cases, it sounds like all that's needed is clarification. In other cases, there's disagreement over policy intention, which is fine. But have you engaged them to just clarify some of these points?
Yeah, so the Agricultural Reform Implementation Oversight Board, AREOB, does contain voices from Nourish and the RSPB, as well as, of course, the farming sector, across the different sectors, so crofters as well as large livestock farmers and arable farmers. So I think we have got a good balance, and we also engage individually with those organisations at official level, but also at a ministerial level. So I think we've been taking advice and input from across the whole sector.
Thanks, Raj. That was really useful. Thank you.
That's good. Thank you. John, to follow by Michelle.
Thanks very much, convener. And if I could maybe return to some of the convener's questioning around the administration costs, and particularly in the financial memorandum in paragraph 47, this figure of £61 million. Now, I was a little bit unclear about the 11%. What was that £61 million 11% of?
Okay, so in the financial memorandum, it says the 2023-24 budget cost to administer payments compliant. So this represents properly. Okay, so that's 11% of the total budget of the schemes that are supported by that administration. So I'll say that again in a coherent way. Okay. So we pay out money to farmers through our support schemes, and to do so costs us administration costs. So the money we pay out is £692 million, and the administration costs to do that are £61 million. And the
that would be less than 10%.
Well, there you go. It wasn't my
no draft. It's a bit off to have a financial memorandum with such an obvious error as that, I would have thought.
Well, I just wondered if it was referring to a different figure, if I was misreading it.
No, I think that's a mistake.
OK, well, leave that with you. I mean, it'd be good if it's less than 10%, I suppose.
We'll check that.
Because my next question would be, you know, is 11% a reasonable figure? I don't know, do you benchmark that with, say, other countries? I mean, I don't know what did Denmark spend? What does anyone spend?
Yeah.
Just for example, last week at Social Security Committee, Social Security Scotland are aiming at 5.2% for their costs of distributing benefits, which is also quite a complex area. That was Social Security Scotland,
oh, big pardon.
And they were at 5.2%. So I just wonder where, you know, is 11% okay? Is it good? How do we judge that?
So, first of all, apologies for the fact that the figures on the face of it don't appear to be correct. But in the defence of colleagues who've prepared this document, the amount that we pay out depends which bit of it that you measure, so whether we include the forestry grants and various other pieces at the margins. The agriculture policy is quite broad in that sense. In terms of the cost to pay and benchmarking, as I said earlier on, the amount it will cost to pay out will be dependent on the complexity and minister's appetite to accommodate more things in the policy. And so it's not the same. It's unfair to compare it with Social Security, which is a larger volume and less bespoke things. But I can feel that Mandy wants to come in, so I'll stop.
Well, I'd also say that obviously there is a core cost of the administration, irrespective of how much grant there would be, actually. You know, so if the budget were to change significantly, then the cost of administration, there's a core cost for staff and IT that doesn't change. So there's a sort of per transaction value that, you know, again, we're examining what good value for money looks like, and in the examination of the business case and what a structure for administration of the future framework could look like that would be more efficient or better value for money, that spectrum of potential budget is an important part of thinking that through. Mm-hmm. And we have got special specialists sort of looking at the figures and trying to look at different scenarios depending what happens.
So even if you paid out no grants, there would still be a core cost?
Well, I guess at the point of you paying out no grants, you wouldn't bother maintaining that. But yes, like if the budget was to reduce to a quarter of what it was, that percentage of the total cost would obviously go up a lot because there are set costs no matter what the grant is.
Sorry, that was a little unfair of me. And is that, I think you're saying that is a factor, one of the factors, when you look at how we might go forward, that if a grant, one particular scheme is, you know, could be run quite easily as compared to another scheme which would be very complex to run, that the cost of administration would be a factor that you would take into account?
Yeah, and the benefits. So benefits versus costs. So that point of we do need to look at what is it giving, not just in terms of financial value, but also the value against meeting the targets around climate change, biodiversity, etc. So it's the benefits versus the costs. So when you're making decisions about the complexity of something, every time there's complexity added, there's cost added. So you need to know that complexity is worth the cost. So those are all part of the decisions that ministers will have to make on sort of individual elements and decisions as we go forward.
Okay, thank you. Now, kind of linked to that, in paragraph 56, it talks about the transition costs, which are to be 64 million. So is that's kind of one-off, I'm assuming, will happen over a period but won't be repeated. And then it goes on to say in the following paragraph about implementation costs, which are not included. It says these costs are currently excluded. So first of all, can you explain to me the difference between transition costs and implementation costs, and then also why the implementation costs are excluded?
The transition costs, again, at the moment, because we are still working through, and that's why these aren't precise, the estimated cost, because we're still working through what the structure could be and what is value for money, what systems do you need, what can be repurposed from here. So the kind of transition is that. The implementation would be around, because we're building the plane while flying it, it's not a simple equation. If we were doing this from scratch, we would be able to know how much something costs. But this is the difference between what we currently pay and what we might pay in the future. So we may find that implementation costs could go down as well as up. So at the moment, we are still working through what the operationalizing of implementation would be. So that would be there will be some costs associated with the transition, additional staff and program costs, and we're looking at IT and those kind of things as well. So that's an estimate of that.
But there isn't an estimate for implementation costs?
I think, as I said, it's because we don't know that there will be increased costs associated with implementation. Right. So the programme as it is at the moment is about transformation of where we are to where we need to be, mm-hmm. and then it would be subsumed back into the business as usual. So in an ideal world, and I can't commit to that because we there's too many don't knows, but in an ideal world, that ongoing implementation and delivery may, because you've made something more streamlined, depending what choices are made, could be less or more, and that's why that's been excluded.
So although it says it's been excluded, effectively it's assuming that the present costs will basically carry on roughly as they are. Is that fair?
Yeah, or being value for money is at the heart of what we are considering in terms of that benefit and cost analysis. So, in an ideal world, you're not looking to increase the administration cost from where they are now in the longer term.
Okay. Thanks. Now, you mentioned IT there, and in paragraph 62, you refer back to last time there was significant IT modernisation and business change, and the figure of 178 million. And in fact, it says it did not deliver all the aims and benefits originally envisaged. So, where are we with IT in all of this?
The current setup is a complex one with multiple systems. So again, as we look into what our target operating model for the endpoint would be, it would certainly be the intention to streamline and simplify where we are at the moment. And some of these systems have just been built up over a number of years and added to over the time. So it's quite a complex picture. So that's this provides this bill and the transformation provides a real opportunity to streamline and improve the situation that's at the moment.
And might that include more IT investment?
Again, this is sort of subject to the decisions that need to be taken about what is value for money and what's not, but that should, the option of additional or changed IT will be part of the business case, but also looking at repurposing what is currently there. So I'm certainly not the IT lead in this space, so it's quite technical and complex, but there is streamlining and improvements that will be needed to go forward to make this a system. So, for example, being able to take advantage of new technologies or being more flexible as you as science improves and things like that are all part of an overall target operating model of processes and systems that can respond to those kind of things. And a lot of that does need transformation.
I mean, I'm assuming that if you tweak the present system, then the IT systems could probably cope with it. But if you do something radically different, we might need a very new system.
Those are the assessments that are being done each time we're looking at the different things, you know, to what extent the current system can be used, to what extent new things may need to be bought. That's all part of this business case and a benefits cost analysis.
Okay.
If I may just add a little bit more, I think it would be fair to say, and I think our IT colleagues would want this said, that any system with any longevity to it requires ongoing investment to keep it current. So I think that any of us who are involved in supporting the sectors need to make sure our systems are kept current. So I think that ongoing investment of your IT is always going to be something that will accrue at least some cost in terms of the financial implications.
And I think that would probably be true with or without these policy changes. Yeah. So even if we hadn't left the EU and this wasn't a thing, that would still be true.
So is that in your budget for the coming year?
The
IT refresh or whatever?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Harker-Johnson previously referred to the crisis reserve. Is that the same as the national reserve that I see referred to?
No, the national reserve deals with the way that we manage entitlements. It's quite a complex area, so I hope you haven't got follow-up questions on that. But so the National Reserve allows us to take in and then issue entitlements for a payment, and using the National Reserve to bring in new entrants is one of the things that, of course, we want to continue to be able to do.
Right, because I don't think the National Reserve is referred to in the policy or financial memorandum, although it had been in the consultation.
So in that sense, it's got to do with whether or not you've got an entitlement to access money rather than money itself. But I'm straying into territory, which is quite technical, and I'm not very sure of my feet.
Okay, well, I'll leave it. I mean, if you want to write to us or anything.
Unless Karen wants to see anything. No.
No. it's certainly, I'm an outsider to this, so I was just intrigued. And my final point was, on the question of costs for other organisations, I think it was the SRUC suggested that farms would have to produce whole farm plans, and there would be a cost to that. Would you accept that, or would you agree with that?
So, of course, businesses have to make plans if they're going to be successful, and we want to support farmers to be doing that. And we, in particular, we envisage that the whole farm plan should give farmers baselining tools. Do we think that there will be a cost incurred in that? Yes. That any activity that you undertake as a business is going to incur you cost, at least opportunity cost of your time. So, yes, we recognise that there will be costs associated with that. But they'll be more than outweighed, we hope, and envisage by the support that's available for doing that. And we'll be saying more about that when we bring forward the whole farm plan proposals, as we hope to do very soon, actually.
Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Perhaps going back to a comment alluded to by the convener earlier, our specific challenge in this committee is to take a view on the financial memorandum as presented, and clearly the questioning thus far has brought out a significant amount of areas where there's uncertainty, and I think we've covered off a lot of them in terms of costs. We know that standing orders basically set some kind of rules around production of FMs and basically the best estimates and costs and savings and so on, and also an indication of the margins of uncertainty and a range, if you like, of costs. So I was surprised when I looked at the FM that they all appear to be fixed costs with all the things that have been brought out thus far, not considering future inflation and, you know, missing certain areas. So what was the rationale for not including ranges which give an indication of certainty or otherwise?
So I think that the principal area of uncertainty is the budget that will be available to us post the election, that's the UKG election. And that the risk associated with that is really large compared with the other risks. So the degree to which you then try and ascribe uncertainty to the other factors, it pales into perhaps maybe not insignificance, but it would detract the value of giving an uncertainty range in terms of the other elements. And so we adopted an approach where we would give the best estimate and then make clear the caveats that are around that in terms of ongoing engagement with the sector about how best to do it, and that may result in varying delivery costs, for example, as we've already discussed. So there's quite a lot of uncertainty about that, but quantifying that uncertainty is really quite difficult, and it would be, we felt that it would be unwise to provide spurious accuracy around that when actually there's quite a lot of unknown. But what we are committing to is delivering the current quantum of the budget. That's all we can predict, and maintaining our delivery costs close to the current level, and the transition costs we've sought to provide an early estimate of, and we're working to make that more accurate as we work through the business case process for change.
I mean, so you've highlighted it's actually uncertainty cubed because of the points you've made. What consideration did you give to other mechanisms? Because I sense that you're kind of going through the process. The process says that you must present an FM in terms of standing orders of the Parliament in the face of considerable uncertainty. Did you consider other approaches, which was now fully accepting the significant challenges around the cliff edge of UK government funding, but did you consider further going further in this process before coming back with an FM? Because you'll appreciate that I think, you know, as a committee, we can't, you know, have a great deal of confidence in it as presented for the reasons you've set out. So did you consider other approaches, perhaps more co-designed to get more firmness around the figures?
So we've been working hard with the sector since the last election, the last Scottish election, in terms of working through the vision towards what a framework might look like. And then we're now working through how that might be implemented. And we've been... So it's fair to recognise that there's been criticism about the time that has taken, and I recognise that. I think we all recognise that. But I think it's also important that we have taken the right amount of time to get that process right and to bring the industry with us, whilst continuing to support our farmers and food producers across Scotland, which we are doing, and continually improving that process in itself. So... we are currently at the position where we have to present these documents to you as part of the standing orders, as you say. So if we had taken longer to do it, would it be better? Yes. But then you wouldn't have it today to scrutinise in advance of the bill process. So we're trying to do those two things in parallel, because that's the right thing to do, rather than to rush through it and present something which is perhaps less accurate, might look better. Mm-hmm. So I think we're being honest about where we've got to, and it's as good as we can make it at this stage.
Mm-hmm. But I think, do you understand the point I'm making, though, about, you know, us in our role, that how confident can we be in the numbers as presented for the reasons that you've set out? You know, I've asked this question before, actually, witnesses, you know, if I say to you on a scale of 0 to 10, where 0 is no confidence and 10 is absolute confidence, what number would you give me specifically on the FM as presented today?
So I'm very confident that what we've done presents an accurate picture up to the point that we're at, notwithstanding the 11%, which should be 8%, I think. That's as good as we can make it. We know that it will improve as we go through the business case in terms of how much the transition is likely to cost us, and we know that the cost to businesses of compliance in the new framework will improve, and we will tackle that during the impact assessments for the subsequent legislation. And that is as good as we can make it, yeah, given that we're trying to do this in an incremental way with, yeah, the sector.
And suppose that goes to an earlier point, again, that the convener alluded to in terms of these framework bills. If you're saying it's as good as it can be at this point in time, and clarity, further clarity will emerge over numbers, that will be beyond the point where the Finance Committee has oversight, and thereby necessarily leading to considerably less financial scrutiny from a parliamentary point of view, therefore logically a higher probability of increased costs, because we've not got our kind of fingers all over it from a purely financial perspective. Do you recognise that that might be a concern for us in terms of, because we consistently are noting that we've got incredibly constrained public finances, but we're building into processes less scrutiny in the face of that, constraint.
Yes, so I recognise that you would feel that way about it. I think the important thing is that the bill provides us with the powers to continue to support farmers in rural Scotland. And in bringing forward the bill, we've set out the purposes for which we intend to do that, and we intend to use as much of the available budget as we can get from the UK Treasury settlement with Scotland and other administrations. So those things, I'm very confident, are right. Mm-hmm. The specific budget that we get is unknown, and it would be unknowable within the lifetime of this Parliament, in fact, and we're duty-bound to take the powers to continue to support farmers in this Parliament. Otherwise, the sunsetting
clause
in 2020...
You can't introduce yet another cliff edge top of the UK government.
So that's where we are. Yeah. And I think ministers and the finance memorandum have set out in good faith where we wish to be. But the powers in the bill, we believe, are the right ones to take. And the implementation measures will be scrutinised in due course when the secondary legislation comes in, and throughout the rest of the progress of the bill itself as more of the details emerges, albeit that will principally be led by another committee. But the other key element is that the budget setting in this area is scrutinised by the Parliament in the budget process in any case, and that would be with or without the bill. So it's in terms of the amount of support available to the farmers and their administration costs, those are already scrutinised by the Parliament in the bill, in the budget bill process in any case. So I think that's the more important element of the scrutiny of the finances that are around agriculture rather than the bill financial memorandum.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Liz?
Thank you. Can I just associate myself with the remarks that Michelle Thompson has, and indeed with Mr Greer, Mr Hulkle-Johnson and Mr Mason's comments, because they have all, in their different ways, exposed a lot of the uncertainty which you yourself, Mr Kerr, have admitted exists. And this is an important bill, especially to support rural Scotland, which has been at the difficult end of a lot of considerations in recent times. If you were in our shoes as members of this committee, would you be accepting this financial memorandum?
Definitely.
Could you just explain why you think it is acceptable to accept it on the basis that there are so many uncertainties within it, which you have admitted to?
So the uncertainties are largely being driven by external factors and our desire to work with the sector to bring forward the best policy implementation we can for the Vision for Agriculture. So I think that those two things are demonstrable by our actions in terms of updating our route map of when we intend to bring forward the different pieces of support, and in terms of the overall budget settlement with the UKG, we've been pressing that continually since the last Scottish election, and previously with Mr Ewing as well. So that's an issue that Scottish ministers and the Scottish Government in general have been completely consistent with. So all of our actions have been have demonstrated our good faith in this area, and we've set out with as much accuracy as we can the position, and we're committed to working with the sector and with the Parliament as we take each step. And we've published when we're going to take those steps. So that's why I think, were I in your shoes, I would accept it.
Mr Kerr, when Mr Greer was questioning, he quoted the section in the financial memorandum that said that you know, it's unclear what the precise split of funding across the tiers is yet to be determined. And it goes on to say that that is a key component of the co-design work currently underway. Can you tell us about this co-design work that is ongoing?
So, in terms of the mechanics of that, we are in routine dialogue with the Agricultural Reform Implementation Oversight Board, AREOB, which is a group from across the different land-based sectors, including some of the NGOs that Mr Greer talked about. We're bringing forward the vision. Then we're saying, well, in order to achieve this vision, for example, in the beef-calf scheme, we think that we need to introduce certain conditions. And then we are working with the sector about whether those conditions will work, the extent to which they'll deliver the outcomes that we're looking for. So in that case, reduced emissions. And then we're looking at how we implement that and the delivery costs associated with that, and then presenting options to ministers for a decision in that. So that is how the mechanism of the co-design work is happening.
So that is not determined by external factors so much as what is going on in terms of Scottish Government policy, is that correct?
So it's driven by stakeholder engagement with our vision and our intended outcomes. So in that sense, we are working through it with the external parties. But yeah, it's largely controlled by us, yes.
Right.
If that's your point, yes, it is.
Well, my point is that if that is controlled largely here in Scotland, with that ongoing co-design, this is an issue that we've had in some other bills, how are we able to interpret what the ongoing costs of that ongoing co-design are going to be if we're not sure what the co-design is going to result in?
I'm not quite...
Well, if there's ongoing decisions to be made through co-design, as the financial memorandum says, how are we able to scrutinise what the costs are associated with that ongoing co-design if it hasn't happened?
Yes, we're not in a position to know the costs yet of individual options, because we haven't reached the point of final advice to ministers on that yet.
Okay, thank you.
Jamie, you want to come in with a question?
Yeah, I was going to come in on some of the comments that John Mason there, but I just want to go. I did ask you about kind of why this process didn't start earlier. You know, why didn't it start earlier? We're 5 years potentially behind other parts of the United Kingdom on this.
So I'm not sure I would agree with the premise of the question in terms of being behind. I think. I attended the NFUS conference in October, and NFUS President Minette Batters talked about where she felt, NFU England and Wales, Minette Batters talked about where she thought other parts of the UK were at, and was very envious about where we are in Scotland. So are we further behind? That depends on
but in this process could have started
what your objectives to be.
We could be more advanced. This process could have co-design, framework, bill, etc., could have started earlier.
It could have done, but we undertook to provide a period of stability and certainty to the sector during and after, immediately after Brexit, which we did. So farmers and crofters in Scotland have a great deal of certainty about their current payments and their payments in the next year or so. And we've also set out clearly what we will deliver to them in future years in terms of our route map. So I think that we are taking our reforms forward at a different pace from other parts of the UK. That's true. But are we behind? Well, that depends on what you're seeking to achieve. I think we've been really clear, for example, in the climate change plan process, that that's an important focus for us in Scotland. We've gone through a process of having climate change example farms, and the monitor farm process has been focused on those things. So our policy journey in support of those outcomes has been steady and clear for some time, and we're at the natural next step now. And the timing is in Scottish ministers' hands. But judging it by another territory's approach is not necessarily a good yardstick.
As I say, I just wanted to really get some clarity. John Mason was talking about the IT support. On table 5 of the memorandum, that's at 60 million. We've talked about that earlier. Can I just get clarity? Is that for streamlining or improving the current system, or is that for delivering a new system?
Not possible to completely separate those things, because we need to do technical evaluation of what needs to be kept within the current system, what might be new, and we are still working through that. And of course, what the structure of it, what capabilities. So, for example, we're looking at capabilities first. What do we need the system to do? How much does current systems do that? What might we do in the future?
So this is very much a best guesstimate.
Yes.
Okay. In March 2003, Informed System were given a £24 million contract for a new IT system. Is that for an IT system, or is that part of this £60 million kind of reviewing? What's there?
I think it's part of that. I'm not certain.
I think it would be... We've undertaken to work with a range of external help, let's say, in order to maintain our current systems, look at what new systems we might have, and also evolving some of our systems to do the new things. So there's a range of those things, and we, from time to time, engage with external contractors to help us with that. And if you want, we're not best placed to say which of those contracts is doing which of those things, because
I appreciate that, but we're looking at the finances on it.
And
as I say, if so that isn't necessary to provide a new system, but if a new system was required, there would have to be additional costs on top. Would you say that, or would that, you know...
It's really hard to see, because at the moment, because we're doing this assessment of what capabilities we're looking for,
right,
to what extent can current systems... Is it desirable for current systems to do that? How much would the maintenance of a current system or improving it compare against buying something new? All of those things are things that we're looking at, so it's impossible to sort of separate out and say right now that we would... there are off-the-shelf systems, for example, that you can buy. Does that represent better value for money than changing what we currently have? We haven't done those assessments of all those different options yet.
I mean, the fear I have is that... I mean, you will be aware, I appreciate it's not your area, but in 2012 we had a new system brought in. It was meant to cost 100... £2 million, it ended up costing £178 million, as John Mason.
Yeah.
Huge potential cost overruns, massive disruption to the sector with costs on top of that. So that's what my fear is. We don't seem to have that clarity on the potential costs of a new system, or, you know, what we're actually going to be looking to deliver here.
So I think this committee took evidence about that at the time, or it's predecessor did, and we're keen to avoid the situation we got into with IT Futures. I was in the directorate, although not in this role at the time, and it was bruising for everyone concerned, including frontline staff who were facing farmers, so I totally recognise that. I think what we've set out here is the additional costs, which is not the current overhead cost of our current system, so that this is what we've set out here is the transition costs. And they're the best guess at the moment. So one of the issues with the previous build was perhaps forecasting the cost too low at the start. Mm-hmm. So then when we were rightly criticised for an overspend, you know, we're keen to avoid that mistake as well. So we would prefer to be... we've set out what we can here, and we're going to improve that and we're working with assistance of experts in this area to put together a more accurate costing of what a future build might cost us.
But that 60 million for that. But that 60 million, if it did require a completely new system, you don't think it would.
So the 60 million is what we currently are forecasting for digital infrastructure, but that could be it might not be accurate, and we will come forward with a new figure in due course. At the moment, we're forecasting that is what the new systems will cost. But as you said, the last time round, it eventually cost 178 or whatever it is published in the PAC report at the time.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, well, that's concluded questions from the committee. I've just got a couple of questions myself to wind up. One, for example, is with regard to paragraph 68 of the financial memorandum, which says, in terms of subsidies, it says, and I quote, those who deliver sustainable regenerative farming will benefit the most. In future, support will be focused on food production, actions to support nature restoration and reduce greenhouse gas emissions in a way that is economically and socially just by maintaining base payments with conditions all farmers, crofters and land managers should be able to meet if they choose. And it's those words, if they choose, almost means that everything I've read out in that sentence is really, well, if they don't want to do it, they don't have to do it. So what incentive is there going to be to ensure that farmers do deliver on what the Scottish Government is seeking in terms of improved food production, better climate actions, etc.?
So the reason that we wrote it in that way is because we anticipate that all farmers will continue to engage with Tier 1, the base support, because it broadly has the current conditions associated with it, with some more that we're bringing in to improve baselining and one or two other things. And we strongly envisage that support will be taken up by those who are currently engaged in food production and will continue to do so. Where we are less certain that there will be engagement is in Tier 2, which will have a significant amount of support associated with it for most businesses, but it will also require them to contribute more with, you know, for that support in terms of environment and nature outcomes. But we currently don't envisage making that tier compulsory. So if farmers choose not to engage in the measures that we bring forward, then they would also not receive the payment associated with it.
See, that isn't really what it says there, though. It's basically talking as if you'll still get the payments whether they meet those conditions or not. That's how it reads.
Well, it's not intended to read that way. It's intended to mean that farmers will only receive support if they meet the requirements of each of the tiers.
Okay, then. Now, my final area is regarding an issue which no one's brought up before, which is the National Test Programme. The National Test Programme will support and encourage farmers and crofters to learn about how their work impacts on climate and nature, including offering financial support to carry out carbon audits, soil testing and nutrient management planning, establishing a clear baseline and options for action for all who participate. Now, here I'm going to declare a constituency interest. 19% of greenhouse gases from Scotland are agricultural. And I'm just wondering whether or not the Scottish Government is looking in terms of its greenhouse gas reduction, introducing the food additive Bovar. It has been developed by DSM in my constituency in Doriath. It was opened by the previous First Minister, St Andrew's Day, 2022. £100 million private investment, £12 million from Scottish Government. And this additive will reduce methane outputs from sheep and cattle by 20 to 30%. And yet I see nothing in here in terms of farmers being incentivised to use such an additive, which has already been used in many areas, and the Dry factory will provide this product worldwide. You know, it's a huge success. DSM chose Dry over 35 other locations worldwide for its production, so delighted it's in my own constituency. But I don't see anything about if we're going to be actually targeting methane reduction, how a product like that, which will be about less than 3%, just over 2% of the agricultural bill, but deliver phenomenally in terms of greenhouse gas reductions through agriculture, if there's going to be encouragement to use that and financial support for farmers to use it.
So at the time of writing the financial memorandum, I don't think at that point that the where had been approved for use. It now has. As it happens, I was at the opening as well and saw the great work that they're doing there in terms of the local employment. But in terms of the use of Bovair as part of delivering emissions reduction, we absolutely recognise that, and that's built into some of our thinking in the climate change plan in terms of the measures that can be used. We do have to work through how it is then reported in the national emissions inventory. So that's an issue that we need to work through at a UK level, not just in Scotland. And then the monitoring and verification of its use on farms. You know, you have to use it properly in order to get the 20 to 30% emissions reduction that you rightly talk about. So we have we do want to work through those issues with the sector. So yes, it's very much on our radar, and the livestock production team in my area are currently working on that, among other things. Of course, there are other ways to reduce emissions from cattle, and breeding is also important. So it's not the only mechanism there, and it, currently the approval doesn't extend to all ruminants. So there's a larger issue, but certainly there is a place for it in the dairy sector, and that is part of our planning.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that, and thank you for your evidence, yourself and your team, Mr Kerr. That's been very helpful. We will consider the evidence received and any next steps that we wish to take in relation to scrutiny of the financial memorandum in private. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of our work programme. So we'll now move into a private session. We'll reconvene at 11:30. Thank you.